A few of the words to this are, sing God a simple song, lauda, laude. Make it up as you go along, lauda, laude. Sing like you like to sing, for God loves all simple things. For God is the simplest of all. God is the simplest of all.
Thank you. Thank you all so much. Welcome to Unity this morning, and you can stay standing. That's great. We're going to start by singing All You Need Is Love. Pleased to have Dan helping out leading the singing this morning.
Nothing you can do that can't be done. Nothing you can sing that can't be sung. Nothing you can say, but you can learn how to play the game. It's easy. Nothing you can make that can't be made. No one you can save that can't be saved. Nothing you can do, but you can learn how to be you in time. It's easy. You know this part. All you need is love. All you need is love. And all you need is love, love. Well, love is all you need. Nothing you can know that isn't known. Nothing you can see that isn't shown. Nowhere you can be that isn't where you're meant to be. It's easy. All you need is love. And all you need is love. And all you need is love, love. Love is all you need. One more time.
All you need.
All you need is love. Everybody now, all you need is love, and together, and all you need is love, love, 'cause love is all you need, love is all you need, love is all you need. Okay, you sounded really good.
Love is all we need, but I may correct the Beatles by saying all we need is to remember that we are love. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our 11 o'clock service, those of you who are here today, and those of you who are connecting right now with our community. Thank you for tuning in and sharing this sacred space with all of us this morning. Like to start off by having all of you with me do our mission. Are you ready? Together. We are a spiritual community awakening to our divine nature through love, service, and personal transformation. And I would like to say that today we are honored to have an awakening presence with us, Ellen Grace O'Brien Yogacharya. Please stand, Ellen, so they can see you already from your seat. As you know, we had a wonderful workshop yesterday afternoon. Many of us were there. It's probably been the most attended workshop ever here on a Saturday, so we give you that recognition. And yes, it was on the Kriya Yoga, and I have a definition here. We have some Kriya Yogis here already, right? It's a philosophy and spiritual practice that supports realization of our oneness with God. As you know, Ellen Grace O'Brien met Roy Eugene Davis in 1979. He comes from the lineage of Paramahansa Yogananda. And she was accepted as a disciple and initiated by him into Kriya Yoga in 1980. In the summer of 82, he ordained her to teach. As the founding teacher and spiritual director of the Center for Spiritual Enlightenment, Yogacharya has been teaching for over 25 years. And today she'll be sharing some more of her wisdom on this her latest book, The Jewel of Abundance. And like I was telling her today, you are a jewel. So thank you for modeling for us what we are capable of expressing. So thank you so much. And besides our service today, she'll be in the afternoon at 1:30 offering another workshop, which I plan on going to. And I hope you can too. I'm sure it will be worth your time. So more announcements. Next Sunday, we are going to have a business fair right in the fellowship hall after both services. We have many of you who own businesses or offer some sort of service will be exhibiting here in that day. We also have people from nearby businesses who are joining in. So we're expecting from 25 to 30, and hopefully we'll have some good samples from the restaurant. So stick around next week. And then on the new photography exhibit that starts on September 4th, it's called Around the World in 90 Days, and Karen and Judy are encouraging everybody here to bring a picture of one of your abroad adventures. There's more information out in the flyers out there. And then I always like, give me something there. So, it's time to fly. You might have seen this poster out or not, but as you know, the Unity Middle Atlantic ministers come together every year and offer a workshop in Canoga, Hendersonville. And this year will be, the keynote speakers are Ricky Byers, so very well-known New Thought singer, and Reverend Linda Martella Wissett. Many of you know her from her book, How to Pray Without Talking to God. She's currently the director of Silent Unity at the Village, and they're both gonna be the keynote speakers. There's flyers out there about the rates and more information. There's an early bird special on August 30th, but everybody's encouraged to visit unityretreats.us. Our US and register there. Many of us are planning on being there, so I hope you can join us. And then last but not least, as some of you may already know, Reverend Beverly Volkover, former senior minister at Unity Church of Raleigh, has had her transition recently. And let's honor a moment of silence on her behalf. Peace, peace, peace. Amen. I believe that she's one of the initial leaders of even this Unity Church of the Triangle, but she served as the senior minister there for many years. There's gonna be a celebration of life service on Thursday, August 29th at 7 p.m. at the Unity Church of Raleigh. So I hope many of you can join all of us in celebrating her life. And we bless you, Bev. We see you being the light in your full expression. And so it is. Okay, I think I'm done with the announcements. I'm going to ask everybody to please stand and join us in singing the welcome song.
Thank you.
And now take a moment to greet the Christ in those directly in front or behind you, and we'll keep it going. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel God's mighty power and God's grace. There's a holy hush around us. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Good morning. During the week, individuals placed the names of those who are in some type of need or just have an intention. And so we take this time to recognize the Christ within those names that are in this box. And it's also a time of yourself to recognize the Christ within yourself. So I'd like to ask those in the prayer ministry, stand and help to hold sacred space while we do so. Let us pray. Take a moment and listen to these words. I would like to invite you to say these words and listen to them as if they were your own. And for those who've placed intentions into this prayer box, direct that energy of these words into this box, seeing these individuals saying these words as well. I am a life-giving spirit made in the image and likeness of God, forever expanding and expressing the goodness that I am. I thrive, I flourish, and I am positively successful in all ways. I am a blessing to my world, and I continuously manifest my divine qualities and attributes to fill needs and heal hurts. I am the master of my world, for I have dominion over every circumstance in my life. I let it be, and it is so. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us open our hearts and our minds to the infinite divine presence. That life, that infinite life, infinite power, that is called by many names, God, Spirit, higher power, truth, love. That which is the source and substance of all that is, that surrounds us and indwells us. So in this moment, as we pause for meditation, let us know and affirm that we are meditating in that. We are meditating in God, and that God is our life, the life of our life, the breath of our breath, the heart of our heart. So use your breath now as the vehicle to carry you into the sanctuary of the soul, the true place of worship. So with your in-breath, just feel that you are diving within into the infinite ocean of divine peace. And with your out-breath, let go. Let go of yesterday, let go of tomorrow, come into the healing, powerful presence of today, of this holy moment.
Daily bread, you said you would. from here and share this love you gave to me. To show someone is lost and help them find their way, the way to truth and faith, so they can be free.
Thank you for the beautiful music this morning. Really appreciated it. And I'm so grateful to be here. I bring you greetings of love and peace from our spiritual community, Center for Spiritual Enlightenment in San Jose, California. I know some are tuning in and sharing this time with us this morning. I'm really grateful to Reverend Newsom, of course, for his invitation to join you, and also that I understand for the past few weeks you've had some lessons out of my new book, Jewel of Abundance, from Reverend Newsom and from Reverend Anna, so I want to thank them both. And today I'd like to just wrap it up and go right to the conclusion of that book. And so my topic is becoming wealth. That's the spoiler to the book on prosperity, that we are not only here to learn how to thrive and to prosper, how to be wealthy in that way, but we are here to become wealth itself. We are here to become a prospering presence. I like to say that there is this, let's call it a prosperity imperative. There is a call that is in our soul, it's in our bones, it's in our DNA that says, get up, get going, thrive, prosper, share, be the growing edge of love in our world. Because here we are. Right? And we are living in an awakening world that is ready for all of us to participate in lifting it up. And I said to Reverend Anna this morning, I said, you know, I'm thinking of this passage to share about, you know, being part of this awakening in our world, and what do you think about that? She said, I think I read it last week. And I said, oh, that's great. Okay, well, I'll just do that again, and we'll underscore it. So I do want to share with you, because it's such a big part of my vision of why I wrote this book on abundance. We live in an awakening world. In a time of individual and global awakening to the great truth that life is one, and that one life is God. As life is God in expression, it is whole, complete, abundant, and lacks nothing. Awakening to this wholeness brings the experience of radical prosperity, or sufficiency, and with it, a new way of living. There is enough for all in God's economy. It's time for us to shed the idea that one person's good is another's loss, and to rise to the truth that all can and must prosper. It's time for us to free ourselves, our world, our children, and our grandchildren from the specter of scarcity. We are awakening to our potential to create a prospering world that works for everyone, evolving from an egocentric model of life to a spiritually based one. Can you sign up for that? As long as we remain in the egocentric system and are unaware of wholeness, there will be lack, fear, and scarcity arising from the collective consciousness. That unawakened consciousness cannot see that we are connected to one another, and we are connected to the earth and to nature and to God. Humanity has lived for centuries with a consciousness of scarcity. The limited thinking that has fomented fear, greed, sexism, racism, xenophobia, militarism, war, and injustices of every kind. It's time for this to change, and we are ready. That is our prospering imperative. So, how do we make that journey of contributing to the awakening in our world? How do we sign up for it? How do we show up for it? So I want to start by saying we're already all signed up. You know, we signed up coming into this expression, and there is the imperative to prosper that knocks at the door of our heart all the time that says, get up, thrive, prosper, contribute your divine qualities to life. Be the growing edge of love in this world. So, you know, when I was writing this book on prosperity, you know, drawn from ancient Vedic principles, it has even a long title. And so my publisher said, you know, you need an elevator speech about this book, you know, which is that like one or two sentences that if somebody in the elevator says, you know, what do you do? And you say, well, I wrote this book, and then you have to describe it before they get out on their floor. And so what I said was, this is a teaching about how to prosper without losing your soul along the way. That's what people say, even in the elevator. They say, I want that, you know, because we all do. We all want to know, you know, how do we keep that dynamic balance in life? And for me, it's really about how do we heal the so-called split between our material life and our spiritual life? And how do we experience it as the wholeness that it is? How do we thrive and prosper and experience success in life without losing our soul along the way? So, of course, I have to be metaphysically correct, especially here at Unity, which is to say that I know we cannot lose the soul because we are the soul. That is the truth of our being. But we surely can lose contact with our soul. And I know that's true because that happened to me. There's a Sufi story that I really like that kind of describes the feeling of it. And this is a story about the wise fool Mullah Nasruddin. And in this particular, there's lots of stories about him, but in this particular one, Mullah is riding a horse which is galloping at top speed, going through town, just blazing right through town, and Mullah's friend is standing on the side of the road, and so he yells out to him, Mullah, where are you going? And Mullah turns his head back to his friend and he says, "I don't know, ask the horse." So, of course, that's a little parable, a little teaching parable for us about how sometimes we can get caught up in the sheer velocity of our life. We can get caught up in the sheer length of our to-do list, to somehow we get carried away by our desires, our responsibilities, and we lose touch with our very soul, with our very self along the way. So I learned a spiritual lesson about this very early in life. And I didn't know that's what it was at the time, but you know how hindsight is so beautiful for us, and we look back and we say, oh, that's what that was. That was really a spiritual lesson in disguise. So here's what happened. I was a little girl, about 8 years old, and I was born in the city of Oakland, California. I'm a native Californian. It's a rare flower that you have right here, a native Californian. And my parents were part of the great migration from the inner city out to the suburbs. And so, you know, it was a wonderful thing because that allowed my parents to buy a home. And I know we were really privileged to be able to have our own little home and have a nice school and all of that. But we moved to Hayward. And Hayward is, and it was at that time, I don't want to diss Hayward, but Hayward was kind of like Hayward. And so at that time, it was just a little developing bedroom community, and the orchards were cut down, and these little suburban tract homes were built. And so there was kind of nothing there. You know, culture was missing, but there was a Mecca. There was a place of pilgrimage in that town, and that was the Southland Shopping Mall. So everybody made their pilgrimage to Southland to get their needs met. And I want to say that there was some salvation for me at Southland. And that came in the form, for an eight-year-old girl, came in the form of Miss Margie's dance studio. And Miss Margie herself, I want to tell you that for me as an eight-year-old girl, meeting Miss Margie, I had my first experience of the goddess. Because Miss Margie had big red hair. She had big hair, and it was bright red, curly. And she had those black glasses that curled up on the ends. And right on the ends, there was rhinestones. She had a purple leotard with a belt and the fishnet stockings, black with the tap shoes with the heel. So that was a spiritual experience for me as an eight-year-old girl. But that was not the lesson. So what Miss Margie taught me that I now know is critically important to our spiritual life was she taught me how to turn without losing my balance. So there's two parts to this. The first thing she said is you have to first connect to yourself. If you start your turn without getting grounded first, you're going to fall over. And the second thing she said was, you have to have a focus. If you're going to turn, and you ever watch those dancers turn and turn, you think, how do they do that? They do it like that. They have a focus. And she said, every time you turn, you come back to your focus, and you don't lose sight of it. And sure enough, that was the instruction. Because as a dancer, if you lose your point of focus when you turn, over you go. And so, as a spiritual lesson for us, those two parts are really critical. One is we need to regularly connect with ourselves before we go running off like Mullah Nasruddin, careening through our life without that connection to our own heart, to our own soul, to God as within and through our life. And so that is our prayer and our meditation every day, taking that moment to just start the day with God, you know, live the day with God. When we make that conscious beginning to our day, it sets that trajectory, doesn't it, for a conscious way of being. So we have that need to connect first to the truth of our being. So we connect, and then we want to have a focus for our life, a spiritual focus. So in the book, I'm talking about these four Vedic goals as a focus for our life and how these ancient seers gave us a pattern for keeping our life in balance and for not losing our soul along the way. These four goals, which I'm going to talk about this afternoon, I hope you're able to join me, these four goals are called the Purush Arthas, and I offer you that very fancy Sanskrit word because it is so meaningful. These are four universal aims. They're called Purush Arthas, and that means for the sake of the soul. Isn't that beautiful? Here are four aims. They're universal. They're for everybody. They're for all time, no matter where you live, no matter where you came from. These are your goals. And these goals are the way that you make sure you don't lose contact with your soul along the way. I like to call them our GPS, our God positioning system. So the first goal of the four is Dharma. Now, Dharma is a word many people are becoming familiar with today. It's entered our English lexicon like yoga. But there's a lot of confusion about Dharma, what Dharma is. And people often think of Dharma as their job, you know, Dharma as their vocation. Oh, that's his Dharma. He's doing his Dharma. I wonder what my Dharma is. But it's a much more comprehensive term that really means to live an awakened life of higher purpose. Dharma is cosmic order. It is the divine purpose that is built into all of life. Dharma is what keeps the planets from running into each other. And so for us to live dharmically is to live our life with spiritual purpose and to live our life authentically, because Dharma also means a thing being what it is. It's authentic living. And for us, authentic living means to wake up to the truth of what we are as spiritual beings and to live that truth. So I had a really fun experience. I've been talking at various churches, sharing about the book, and had an opportunity to speak with a congregation in Atlanta. And I was also doing a workshop there. So the woman who was announcing my workshop said, you know, Yogacharya Brian's here with us, and she's going to talk to us this afternoon about Dharma. And then she paused, and she said, I want you to be aware that I did not say drama, because she said, we already know what drama is, but today we have a chance to learn about Dharma. So I loved that so much, and I've kind of carried it with me, and I got this insight from her that whenever we have too much drama in our life, it means we don't have enough Dharma. It's such a good prescription, isn't it? If we find ourselves too caught up in the story and the drama, then it's time for us to return to living with higher purpose. All right, so aim number one is Dharma, to live our life with higher purpose. Aim number two is the topic of my book, The Jewel of Abundance, and that aim is wealth. So this is a spiritual program, and Purusharthas, remember, means for the sake of the soul. So one of the questions is, how do we get wealth on that list of four? Dharma, okay, live with higher purpose. But why is wealth on the list? It's a little bit curious. You can tell we really explore what it means. It means that we are here to thrive and prosper so we can fulfill our dharma, so we can do what we're here to do. And in order to do that, we have to learn how to thrive, how to call forth the resources that are necessary to make the contribution that we are here to make. And so thousands of years ago, the sages had that wisdom. They said, artha, which is wealth, is here to serve dharma. But sometimes we get it, you know, reversed, and we get on that horse of trying to prosper and thrive, and we forget that it's supposed to serve dharma. So this is something to say about the order of it as well. Third goal is pleasure. Now, you're a very quiet group, but I would like to hear something when you hear. We have four ancient, time-tested, universal spiritual goals. Live with higher purpose, prosper, thrive, and enjoy your life while you're at it. Hallelujah. And there is such wisdom in that, such divine wisdom in that, because the very nature of the soul is bliss. Remember how Joseph Campbell said, follow your bliss? And some of us thought it meant ice cream. But it was about following the soul's joy. And so if we find ourselves on that treadmill, on that hamster wheel of trying to get ahead, trying to thrive, trying to prosper, trying to do good spiritually, and we're trying so hard that we've made ourselves miserable, we have left out the third goal. How critical that one is, to enjoy our life along the way. Do you see how these checkpoints are so amazing for us? So live with higher purpose, learn how to thrive and prosper so you can do what you're here to do. Enjoy your life along the way. And the fourth goal is called moksha, which means enlightenment. Now, where did that one go in your basket? So I usually find when I'm talking about this, people are taking notes. Okay, higher purpose, check. I got that. I'm doing that. Prosper, yep, I'm on to that. Pleasure, oh yeah. Enlightenment, really? Really? So remember, these are goals for everyone. And if we just look at the teachings of the saints and the sages, the yogis, and the masters of all traditions, we look at the teachings of Jesus, we look at the teachings of Buddha, we look at Paramahansa Yogananda's teachings, what do they say? They say the same God is in every one of us that was in them. They say the potential for awakening in every person is the same. But somehow we've wired it up that only certain people have that capacity for enlightenment. And the teachings of yoga philosophy say that the greatest obstacle that we have to spiritual enlightenment is the idea that it's not possible for us. And so we don't include that in our plan. We don't gear our life in that direction. So that becomes our greatest impediment. But if we really study the teachers, we see that they say, it's for you. It's for you to wake up fully in this lifetime and to experience liberation of consciousness, to be supremely free. And Yogananda described it this way. He said, we have the capacity as we awaken to live by the promptings of the soul and not by the patterns in the mind from our past. We have that power, we have that potential to be free. So that is goal number four. It's a beautiful teaching, and you can see that living with higher purpose and enlightenment are kind of like a bookends to wealth and pleasure. You know, we don't really get to put wealth and pleasure. Well, we could, but if we put them first on the list, we sort of wander off like Mullah on the horse and have a hard time coming back to living with higher purpose and enlightenment. So, how to prosper without losing our soul along the way. Connect with yourself. Know the truth of your being. Every day, remember that divinity of your own soul, your own essence. And understand that your prospering path in life is not separate from your path of spiritual transformation. In fact, it is your path of spiritual transformation in the right context. You know, you've probably heard that saying, it's easy to be a sage on a mountaintop. You heard that one? It's easy to be enlightened, to be a sage on a mountaintop. Well, I like to say, well, if you're living in a cave in a mountaintop, you're probably not married. So you don't have that person to tell you, to remind you how you need to grow. But to be a sage in the world, buying and selling in the marketplace, as the Sufi poet said, and never once forgetful of God, that's the path. That's the path to be the growing edge of love. And so as we put ourselves out there in the world to do our part, we find how we can grow. It's a continual path of spiritual transformation. So I want to close with a little reading about what we really love, and a little poem as I finish up. What we really love, a successful life, a fully prospering life, is only possible with the soul's joy, never without it. This joy is not a heady happiness, an emotional reaction to life's experiences. The joy, the soul's joy, is life-giving refreshment, like a bubbling spring that rises from the deep ground of our being. It continually refreshes our life with the crystal clear waters of self-knowing, capital S, self-knowing. It's the experience of being fully alive, in love with life, eager to greet each new dawn wearing the colors of possibility. To succeed, it's a little formula. Optimize your life, sanctify your days, Make a sanctuary for the soul. Build it with love. Light it with peace. Invite everyone in. Make a sanctuary for the soul. Build it with love. Light it with peace. Invite everyone in. Center yourself, your small self, in your capital S self. Center yourself in yourself. Nourish your body. Open your mind. Honor your soul. Change your thoughts and soar beyond them. Namaste. Thank you so much. You're such a warm community. Let's just pause for a moment of prayer. Let our prayer today be thank you. Thank you, God, for this life. For this life we have been given. For the divine possibility of this life. For the call to prosper and to thrive and to express the soul's joy. Thank you for the call to be the growing edge of love in my family and in this world. Thank you, God, for this day and all the blessings that it brings. May we go forth now with an awakened heart and behold your divine light awakened and shining in hearts everywhere. Om, peace, peace, peace. Amen.
Our prayer for you is thank you for being here today, for sharing your light, for being so adept at facilitating our awakening, and for the way that you are able to express these principles in such an understandable way.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. So let's bless her with our unity blessing. Please stand and put your hands together. You know it.
I'm being blessed on high also.
Yes.
Great.
Yes. So together, we love you, we bless you, we appreciate you, and we behold the Christ in you. Thank you.
Thank you all so much.
Our wealth is not measured by our accumulations, but by what we give. And as Ellen has said, we have enough. So our generosity opens up the path for us to align with grace. So I invite each and every one of you to gift to your spiritual community in a way that shows your appreciation for this place and for your own enlightenment. So put your gifts in your hand or in your heart, if you are a consistent giver, and let's say our affirmation together. Divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. And Ellen will be available after the service in the lobby to sign your book or to purchase another book. So now, thank you, Kevin, for sharing your light and your gift with us.
So we have another Leonard Bernstein song for you. This is from Trouble in Tahiti. And I think it's helpful to know what it's about. There is an invitation in this song. So I encourage us to hear that invitation as I read the words and as we play it. So the character, the singer, is recalling a dream that she had. I was standing in a garden gone to seed, choked with every kind of weed. There were twisted trees around me, all black against the sky, black and bare and dead and dry. My father called, "Come out of this place." I wanted to go, but there was no way, no sign, no path to show me the way. Then another voice was calling. It barely could be heard. I remember every word. "There is a garden. Come with me. Come with me. A shining garden. Come and see. Come and see. There, love will teach us harmony and grace. Harmony and grace. Then love will lead us to a quiet place."
Thank you. My name is Janice Falcon, and I'm the youth director. And oh, thank you. And today I have a very special thing we're all gonna do together. We have our volunteers of the month, and they are the youth ministry volunteers. If you're here, can you please come on stage? I know Kathleen is here, Mackenzie. Guys, come on, don't be shy. Holly, Tanya, everyone please take center stage. So these are the people that every Sunday they sign up to teach the kids. Some of you help me with specific things, like when I need gifts for a raffle, when I need stuff for a party, and I mean, they are my inspiration, along with the kids we serve, of course. So I hope everyone's here, and we're gonna bless them. So we're gonna bless them with all our hearts, and they will receive, they will receive a gift. I thought, what can we give them that's enough? Nothing's enough, right, for what they do? So I decided nothing I could buy would be enough, so we made something special with my hands, and my mom helped me, and she's here somewhere, and I want to thank you, Mama. I don't know where you are. Oh, there she is. Gracias. I wanted to give her a shout out. So, guys, kids, let's stand up, and along with the congregation, we're going to bless these special people. So, we're going to use our usual blessing, and the YOU are going to put the sherry on top. You'll hear it. Okay. Youth ministry volunteers. Oh, wait, I have something really important. So, this guy right here, he's our youngest youth ministry volunteer. He's our youngest, and he's helped me so much. So a special shout out to him. Thank you. Okay, now we're ready. Youth ministry volunteers, we love you, we bless you. And we truly appreciate you, and we behold the Christ in you.
We love you, really love you.
Thank you, guys. Okay. And now Reverend Mimi will bless the youth as usual. Thank you for
your
attention.
So will all the children please stand so we can give you our blessing? Let's rub our hands together and say, you are loved, special, and important, just the way you are. So together, let's join hands and sing the peace song.
Thank you.
The love of God enfolds us.
I am the love of God.
The power of God protects us.
I am the power of God.
And the presence of God watches over us.
I am the presence of God.
Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Have a joyful week.